give you a gift. Just fill out the connection card. Come meet us at the Next Steps Hub located in the lobby. Discovering Calvary is coming up October 22nd from 4 to 6 p.m. This is where you go to hang out with the staff of our church as we let you know what it looks like to become a member of Calvary. You can sign up at calvarymo.com. Dinner and childcare is provided. Our church is a family on mission to know Jesus and change the world. And one way we do that is through life groups. Life groups are small communities that help us grow closer to God as we grow closer as a family. No matter your age or stage of life, we encourage you to join a life group and see why life is better together. Life groups meet Sunday mornings, Wednesday nights, and even throughout the week. To find out more info about any life groups, go to calvarymo.com. Our quarterly business meeting is next Sunday, right after the 10:30 service. And if you'd like a copy of the business report agenda, it's available today in the back of the worship center. Calvary, thank you for your generosity. We are able to continue our work as the hands and feet of Jesus because of your consistent serving and giving. If you came prepared to give today, there are giving kiosks located around the building for you. You can give online at calvarymo.com as well. And if you are new here, please feel no obligation to give. We are just so glad you are here with us. Thanks so much for joining us. Our prayer for you today is that as we open God's word together, you are inspired to be on mission with us, to know Jesus and change the world.
Family.
Good morning.
How y'all doing this morning?
Good.
Come on. How you doing this morning? There you go. Awesome. Guys, it is my pleasure to baptize this morning one of our students in our student ministry. What's amazing is I met with Autumn and discussed with her on Sunday about what it means to be baptized. And just to hear her heart and how God is both encouraging her to follow him in baptism and convicting her of making sure she follows Jesus well. God, this is just a huge pleasure of mine. So I'm going to invite Autumn Guest to come on down. Jesus, your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. Autumn, it is my pleasure to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with him in the likeness of his death, and raised to walk in newness of life. Great job. Thank you.
Well, that's reason to celebrate, right? Let's celebrate together through singing. I'm ready.
Consider all the worlds I hands have made.
so good to see everybody. It looks like everybody finally made it in. Let's take a second and say hi to some people around. I see some new people out there, so say hi to somebody that you don't know.
And now testimony,
how do you work this thing? Hey, I got it. Hey, this is Megan and Parker Glaus. Say hi, Megan and Parker. Hey, they just got back about a week ago from a mission trip in Alaska with, I think, 21 other people. Well, 19 other people, so that would be 21 minus 2. Anyway, I'm going to give them the mic, and they're going to tell us all about the trip. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. They're going to tell us all about the trip, and so let's just welcome them in.
Good morning, Calvary. How is everyone this morning? Good. Well, I'm Parker. This is my wife, Megan. We just got back from Alaska, like Cody said, about a week ago, and we just wanted to share a little bit of how, or the things that we did. So we'll have some pictures on screen, and we'll just kind of talk about them as we go through. First thing I would like to do is thank God for allowing us to travel to and from Alaska safely and allowing us to have a successful mission trip. And then we would also like to thank you, Calvary, for your generous giving, your prayer, support, and everyone who helped make the trip a success. So thank you. The first two places that I'll kind of talk about, and then Megan will talk about the other two that we visited. The first was a food pantry called New Hope Ministry, and they run a food pantry for the homeless. And Alaska, you look at it and you think there's so much beauty and everything, but there's also so much darkness just kind of overlaying everyone. Whenever people go to Alaska to live, they just kind of want to get away and they don't want to have any kind of interaction. So there's a lot of homeless, there's a lot of drug and alcohol abuse, just so many dark things going on up there. So just allowing us to go up there and kind of help that ministry by cleaning, organizing their pantry, just painting walls, allows us to kind of give just a glimmer of light to that area and hopefully help them out as in years to come. The second place we that we went and helped was Cross Trail Ministries. They have a new chapter in Alaska, and what that ministry does is allow young boys to go out into the wilderness. They kind of rough it. They get to hunt, and then they also spread the word of God around a campfire, so doing a lot of awesome things. So we got to help their leader, Luke, winterize his new home. He had bought a home in either May or June of this past year, and hadn't quite got a chance to winterize it. So here, we have basic winterizing stuff. The ground freezes maybe about a foot down. Up where he is in Chickaloon, it freezes down a little over 4 feet. So we had to dig down around his house about 12 to 24 inches, had to pack a whole bunch of insulation under his house, and then kind of board it shut. And that was our main project. We did a couple other things while we were there, but it was just a blessing to help him and his ministry. So I'll pass it on to Megan. She can talk about the other two.
Hi, everyone. What I would like to talk about, which I felt was most impactful for myself, was we hosted a parents' night out for Radiant Church and Ridgeline Church. So just to kind of paint the picture a little bit, we didn't have very much expectation going into the parents' night out. We knew there were going to be some sort of amount of kids and knew that we were going to spread the word and host like a VBS kind of style. As we were waiting for the kids to arrive, our pastor, Fred, received a phone call asking if we would be okay with accepting a child who had Down or autism. Of course, he said that was more than okay, not expecting at what level that he would be at when he arrived. A little bit about myself. I am an occupational therapy assistant. I've worked 3 years in pediatrics. And so I felt God tell me, like, this is going to be okay. I let my team know that I've had experience with kids with disabilities and that it was going to be fine. As the night drew closer and kids started showing up, over 80% of our nursery had high needs. What that kind of looked like was several having feeding tubes, oxygen tanks, IVs that if they didn't receive the medication, then they would not survive, as well as a child who had a severe heart deficit, that if he got too upset, then we in turn blue that we had to call 911. So very, very high needs. So you can imagine the parents were so excited to have a night out, to be able to connect with their spouse or go run some daily errands. We were able to love on the kids. And as parents came back to pick up their kids, they were so excited that they had never had a night out, or they only get two nights out a year. So we were able to love on those families and bless them with some much needed alone time. The next and last thing that we worked on, we worked closely with Ridgeline Church. We worked side by side with their members on showing them how to reach out to their community. They had just moved into a new location, so not very many people knew who they were or where they were located. So we went out and hung 1,000 door hangers, and if there were opportunities, we were able to talk to them about Ridgeline. That was a pretty amazing experience. Parker and I both have experience on our own outreach here, where we go into our community and knock on doors to... So that gave us the confidence to be able to teach and show Ridgeline members how to do it and how easy it is. And you will run into people who just are very closed-minded, and that's okay. We're just there to scatter seeds. We weren't able to see the fruit of our labor, but that will be for years to come. And so overall, it was a great opportunity, and I thank everyone who were able to make this possible for us.
Thank you so much for sharing. I know for me, anytime I'm up here talking, it's very nerve-wracking. I'm like, ugh. And so they did. They killed it. So thank you so much for sharing. Good job. Let's go ahead and stand up, and we're going to pray, and then we're going to go into a few more songs. Father, we love you. God, thank you for using us as your hands and feet and letting us be part of your story, God. Thank you for this team that went to Alaska, God. Thank you for what you have done. Through them, the work that you were able to do and the work that you are continuing to do throughout this world, God. Help us see our place and whatever that might look like as we move forward, God. Lord, as we go into another time of singing praises to you, Lord, I just pray that our hearts will be opened to your goodness, your greatness, and you will be glorified. It's to you we sing and pray. Amen. Thank you.
You, Jesus, I was a prisoner. Now I'm not. With your blood, you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross.
God, thank you so much for the cross.
Thank you.
Thanks for singing with us. Thanks for hanging with us, kids. Have a good day. You guys can have a seat.
Part two of this series called You Asked For It. We're taking a break from our study of the book of John, and back on Easter Sunday, we surveyed all the people here, and we gave you a list of 20 or so items or subjects, and we asked you to vote on the ones you wanted to hear most about. And so that's what we're doing for the month of October. We'll jump back into the Gospel of John in the first of November, but today I am pleased to teach about parenting God's way. And we're going to be in a variety of passages today. Normally I tell you to open your Bible to a certain passage, but today we're going to look at many different passages. So we'll just jump right into the message. Well, there are these microchips. Anybody ever realize that you've learned more about microchips in the last like 3 to 4 years than you've known in your whole life? Semiconductor chips. These chips are very interesting. They have tons of transistors inside of them. In fact, I've learned this past week that one transistor in a microchip is about 10,000 times smaller than a human hair. And I got to be honest, I don't even know what that means. But that's pretty impressive. There are these chips, these semiconductors, in all electronics. So everything from your electric toothbrush to your car. And back in 2020, when a pandemic broke out around the world, we had some difficulty with these chips. Anybody remember this happening? And so in 2020, when COVID happened, the automobile industry decided that they thought that the demand for new cars would be limited, and so they canceled the order on many of the chips that they needed to make for the different car components. The problem is it takes 12 to 20 weeks just to make one of these chips. And all of a sudden, there came back this demand for new cars, but there was no supply. So you remember this happening? Like you would pass car dealers with no new cars in the parking lot. You couldn't buy a new car. All of a sudden, the prices of used cars went up, and the mechanic shops were backed up. Remember? It was crazy. So if you were a mechanic, you had work forever because everyone wanted to work on their car. Now, fortunately, if you're like me and you're not necessarily inclined to work on your car, every one of your cars right now in the parking lot has inside somewhere its own owner's manual, right? You've seen this. This is in it. Teenagers, if you're starting to drive, this is in your car. And it's not just a random manual for any car. It is specific to your car. You can pull out that manual. You'll find out how to maintain your car. You'll find out what to do if something is going wrong in your car. Every single one of your cars has inside an owner's manual, and you ought to read it from time to time. It is helpful. So today we're talking about parenting. So the question that I was wondering is there an owner's manual? You know, when your child is born and you're holding them in the hospital, wouldn't that be great if it just coming along with it was their owner's manual? Wouldn't that be great just for that specific child, you know? Things in there like, don't feed them after midnight. You know? That's a Gremlins reference. Anyway, so, but the truth is, we've been given an owner's manual. We've been given the Word of God, and so we're going to look today at some of the tools from the Word of God. Now, like last week, we talked about marriage. It's going to be kind of like drinking out of a fire hydrant. This is its own series. There should be a whole series about parenting, and it should start with Deuteronomy chapter 6, and it should just kind of work its way into Ephesians chapter 5, but I have one Sunday to talk about parenting. Now, I want to just say a couple of things on the front end. There are only a handful of perfect parents in this room today, and so if you have not yet had children, would you raise your hand if you've not yet had children? Everybody, let's give it up for the perfect parents. You are. You are. I was a perfect parent on September the 24th of 2005, and then my first child was born the next day. And I was perfect until then. So I just want to say, I've got six kiddos ranging in ages from 5 to 18. I just want to say, I am not a perfect parent. My wife is not a perfect parent. We don't have it all figured out. I don't know how my kids are going to turn out. They've not grown up and left my house yet. So I realize, like, I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage teaching on this subject, but nonetheless, this is the subject that we're going to talk about today. I want you to know before we begin that I fail at home every single day as a dad. Anybody else with me on that? Every day when I go to bed, I think of things that I could have done better as a father in my house to my kids. So I am not speaking today as an expert, but just someone who's on the journey with you today. So I just want to give us a few principles as we journey together this morning. Now, I do want to say before we get into principle number one, that you as a parent, if you're a parent in the room or hoping to be someday, you are primarily the discipler of your family. And so we have our kids' ministry, which is awesome, and Tyler and Janice and Sarah do an incredible job. We have a student ministry, and it's awesome, and Travis does a great job leading our student ministries. But parents, listen, you are the primary discipler of your child. In other words, they need to see Christ in you. Let me just say it this way. They need to know more about the Lord than just showing up to church on a Sunday. Just getting them to church is a good start, but it is not the finish line. So you are the primary discipler of your child. All right, here we go. Let's just talk about some general principles of parenting, and I'm going to pray because I just want to be honest. As you know, God has a sense of humor, and I'm talking about parenting today. Last night, I was picking up two of our children from a homecoming dance at 11:40 at night in Rogersville. That's right. I got home after midnight. I'm usually in bed at 10 o'clock at night. So I don't know what's going to happen or what I'm going to say, but just give me some grace. All right. All right, let's pray. Father, I lift up the next generation to you, God. I lift up the generation of moms and dads, single moms, single dads, divorced moms, divorced dads. Lord, for the couple that's hoping to have children someday but struggling, God, I lift all these people up to you. God, for the parent that today has raised their children and they're doing well, I lift them up to you. For the parent that's raised their children and as far as they could tell in this moment, their children aren't walking with you, God, would you give them grace today? And would they be encouraged today? Father, help us as we seek you today. We pray this in the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. All right, here's the number one principle. Think biblically. Think biblically. The world is going to teach us how to parent, but we need to examine the Word of God, because we need the Word of God to teach us how to parent, not the world. So Romans 12, 1 and 2 is a great principle here. Don't be conformed by the ideas of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We can decide that the world is going to tell us how to raise the next generation or the Word of God. But we need to think biblically. I was reading a helpful book about this called Parenting by the Book by Dr. John Roseman. He was explaining how in the 1960s something happened in the landscape of our country that affected parents. It was called postmodern psychological parenting. And these were the pillars of postmodern psychological parenting. Number one, Sigmund Freud. He's the father of modern psychology. He introduced something to us called psychological determinism, which is the notion that human behavior is shaped by early childhood experiences, that we can trace most of the issues that we have in life back to when we were young, and we can determine how we turned out based on what happened to us at a young age. That was from Sigmund Freud. Following him, we have the humanist. And they propose two concepts. You probably have felt these or heard these from the world. Number one, children are fundamentally good. Children in the core of who they are actually good, right? And number two, high self-esteem is a desirable attribute. That what we need to raise is children who think highly of themselves. And then third, there's a behavioral school. The behavioral school taught us that the behavior modification can be used on humans just like it is on animals. So you have these three pillars of this postmodern psychological parenting, that this idea that everything that's wrong with us can be traced to our childhood, that we're born inherently good, and that children are inherently good, and that we can modify their behavior. And that sounds great, and that sounds reasonable until your newborn turns 2 years old. Anybody ever had a two-year? And it debunks all three of these pillars. And if something happens when your kid turns two, they start using this one word, no. Something happens. I like what the author says here. He says, the metamorphosis is usually sudden and startling. One remarkable night, parents put to bed an 18-month-old who has been to that point cuddly, affectionate, and easygoing. And the next morning, when they walk into his bedroom, they are met by the spawn of Satan, who announces that their parenting honeymoon is over. The two-year-old emerges as the center of their own universe. Everybody experience this. They believe that this world and their parents must cater to them. They don't mind fighting, yelling, biting, screaming to get their way, and they're only two. So could it have been the experiences early in life that have turned them into these little monsters? No, because they're only two. They've been provided for and loved on and taken care of all the way up to this point. Could it be that something is wrong with your child because children are inherently good and you just have a demon-possessed one? Maybe. Could it be that all you need to do is modify their behavior and therefore you will produce a more respectable two-year-old? No, because they have something that animals don't: free will. They're different. But this is what we've been taught in our culture, and we see it today. We see today the idea that the most important thing we can give to our children is high self-esteem. We have helicopter parents. We have bulldozer parents. We want to do everything that we can possibly do to make sure that our child thinks as highly of themselves as they possibly can. We somehow believe that our children are inherently good. We've been influenced by the teachings of this world. Does the Bible have an answer? Yes, but it is countercultural. Number one, Romans chapter 5. Listen to this. This will explain a lot. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, Adam, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. What you have, that little bundle of joy that you're holding in the hospital room, is a little sinner just waiting to be awakened. It's what you're holding. Listen to this next verse. Psalm 51:5, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. There is this reality from the scripture that we are born sinful. We are affected by the fall. We are born in sin and iniquity. That's where we are. That's where we all start out. All have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. I learned a valuable lesson as a student pastor. What I learned as a student pastor, having no children of my own, I started in Boone, North Carolina when I was in college. And here's what I learned quickly. I learned that I had teenagers, and I learned that their parents never thought that they could do any wrong, even when I caught them doing wrong. And I would tell their parents, hey, this is what your son did on the retreat. There was an utter shock and disbelief that their teenager could have done anything wrong. So I learned early on in student ministry that there are parents who truly believe that their children are inherently good. Then I became a pastor in Evansville, Indiana, a student pastor there. Lo and behold, although it's half the country away, the parents there felt the same way about their children, that their children couldn't do anything wrong. And so unfortunately for my kids, I'd made a covenant with the Lord when I was a youth pastor, and I said, Lord, whenever I have teenagers and our youth pastor tells me that they've done something wrong, they will be guilty until proven innocent. Because they're affected by sin. So we got to think biblically here. We got to know what we're up against. We got to know what we're dealing with here. This is a battle that's not just a flesh and blood battle. This is a spiritual battle, this battle that we're fighting of parenting. Are there any parents in the room who would be willing to say, I know that my kids are sinful? Anybody in the room? Yes, Lord. Okay, good. We got to think biblically. Secondly, we got to cultivate responsibility. We got to cultivate responsibility. I love what Galatians chapter 6 teaches us. It says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. I think as a parent, one of the greatest gifts that we can give to our children is to teach them the principle of the harvest. The principle of the harvest says, whatever you sow, you will reap. Now, in our culture today, we have a lot of teenagers and a lot of children who are sowing irresponsibility, but the reality is that their moms and dads are reaping the seeds that their children are sowing. There was a time in our culture, and some of us in the room remember it, when your parents let you reap what you sowed. Anybody remember those days? They'd say, well, you made your own bed. Now it's time to lie in it. Anybody remember those days? Anybody remember the days where when you did not do your book report and you had to go to school the next day, you just went to school and you got an F? Anybody remember those days? Those days are long gone. We would do well to teach our children the principle of the harvest, that whatever we sow, we will also reap. I was in the second grade, and in the second grade at Paul Creek Elementary School, my dad taught me the principle of sowing and reaping. Every day at school, we could take a book home, and we could read that book and bring it the next day. Having completed it, we could get points, and these points would build up and we'd get some kind of reward. And I enjoyed reading, so I took a book home each day and I'd read that book and bring it the next day and trade it out. And I was running out of books, and so I grabbed this book. I have a picture of it here. I grabbed this book off the shelf thinking that I would read this book, Chief Black Hawk. It was one of the only ones left. It was kind of a thick book, but I thought I would take it home and I would read it. And truth is, I took it home and it was boring. It was such a boring book. I'm sure it's probably great, but it was boring to me. And so I took it back the next day. I turned it in. I got points as if I had read it. And I picked another book. But my teacher, Miss Kiesler, was friends with my stepmother, Nancy, which is never a good thing. And Miss Kiesler thought, wow, boy, that is a thick book. I can't believe that little Freddie was able to read that in one night. And so she calls my stepmother, Nancy. Hey, Nancy, Fred turned in Chief Blackhawk today. Did you see him reading all day yesterday afternoon? Like, was he just reading all into the night? Nancy says, well, I don't remember seeing him reading at all. And Miss Kiesler says, well, that's what I thought. But, you know, he took this book yesterday and he turned it in today. And so you might want to talk to him about it. Well, of course, I got home from school that day and Nancy sits me down. She says, hey, Fred, can you tell me the story of Chief Blackhawk? And I knew I was busted. And so I said, well, I didn't exactly read it. So Nancy went up to the school, and she reserved Chief Blackhawk for me. And for the next week, every night at bedtime, I laid there in the bed. My dad laid next to me, and I would read a page out loud, and my dad would read a page out loud. I would read a page out loud for an entire week. I think he hated it just as much as I did. But I'm telling you, early on, I remember I learned the lesson, the principle of the harvest from parents who were not Christians, but wanted to teach me to do the right thing. And that when you don't, there are consequences. And what they were teaching me is, hey, son, we're not bearing the consequences, you are. And so they taught me really early the principle of the harvest in a practical way. They did not let me lie and get away with it. I don't know about our culture today and the way that we are, but I know this, that if your son plays basketball, but he is not in the starting five, it's not because he's not good enough. It's because the coach is dumb. It's not because he's 5'4 and you can't slide a piece of paper under his vertical jump. It's not because he can't dribble, shoot, pass, play defense, or have a good attitude. It can't be those things, not your son. It has to be the coach. Is it possible that the school has hired someone who doesn't understand the concept of basketball as much as you do? So what do parents do? Well, they call the school board. They give the coach a hard time because it's the coach's fault. When your child is flunking out of their class, it's not their fault. Their math teacher just doesn't understand math. Like, how did this person get a degree in math? It cannot be my student. It can't be my child. It has to be this person. We are living in a weird world where our kids should all be on the starting five. They should all be the starting quarterback of Republic High School. They should be the captain of the basketball team or the cheerleading team. They should be the captain of whatever team that they're a part of. They should at least be in the starting rotation. They should be at the top of their class. And if they're not, it's not your fault and it's not their fault. It's someone else's fault. We are raising a generation of irresponsible people. Don't take my word for it. I asked a college professor who teaches at a nearby university, has been teaching there since the mid-2000s and teaches there today. This college today costs $34,000 a year to go to. I asked the college professor to describe the students when they started and the students today. And this is in this professor's own words. And by the way, the program that the professor teaches in is a highly academic, highly sought out program. So here you go. This teacher says, when I started, when I would walk into a classroom before class started at this college, students were talking to each other. This was back in the mid-2000s, or they would chat with me. Before, during, or after class, students would ask questions, and they would take notes, not all of them, but the majority of them. They would study for exams, they would take notes, and they would turn in assignments as the minimum that they did, with many going above and beyond the minimum requirement. Requests for extra credit would happen, but usually at the end of the semester after they'd done the majority of the work. Overall, students seemed to be more aware that work was required to get the grades that they wanted, and they were willing to put in that work and ask for help. Students were interested in building relationships with faculty and other students. It wasn't uncommon for our offices as faculty to have students in them throughout the day who were stopping by to chat or to fill us in on what was going on in their lives. These same students would keep in touch with us after they graduated, often letting us know how they were and how they were using what they had learned in our classes, or telling us how they appreciated how hard we pushed them in class because it was beneficial to them in their career. Fast forward to what is it like to teach the same classes to these students today. Today, before class starts now, students are on their phones, laptops, or have headphones on. There is no relationship building, no sense of community if they don't already know each other. Students are no longer asking questions in front of their peers or at all. They seemingly don't want to admit that they don't know something, which is hindering the learning process. Studying for exams seems to happen the day before, if at all. Students don't seem to know how to take notes or what is noteworthy. I've banned laptops from my classes as a means of taking notes because of the distraction to do something else is too tempting. So most students just sit and stare at me while I lecture because they don't know what to do. Just not turning in their homework because they forgot to do it or didn't bother to do it is common. Requests for tests, retakes, and extra credit start at the beginning of the semester and are both assumed to be common practice. When students are pushed to find their limits or work at a higher level, they're quick to complain to me. They go over my head with a complaint about unfairness. They look for a loophole or shortcut or shut down totally. I rarely have students stop by my office to chat anymore. Face-to-face communication is something they tell me that they hate. They don't see the value of relationship or networking that can happen with their professors, and instead are only interested in communicating via email, text, or social media, which they don't realize is not helping them in the long run. I don't need to comment, but these are students from this area in a college that's nearby with high academic standards that cost $34,000 a year. Something is happening. We are not teaching responsibility to the next generation. We are not teaching the next generation how to communicate. Now, I'm guilty of this, so don't shoot the messenger. Parenting does not mean that you give your child a screen. They're not learning how to communicate. They're not learning how to function. Not saying they should never have it, but man, we've got to be careful. We've got to teach them to be responsible. Number three, prioritize relationships. I touched on this last week, I think, in the second service. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 says this. I think we have Genesis 2, 24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his children, and they shall become one flesh. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother, and they together should hold fast to their children, and they shall become one flesh. That is not what the Bible teaches. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Flesh. I'm going to say something that is countercultural, and it's actually, I think, even countercultural in the church. The most important relationship in your life as husband is the relationship with your wife. The most important relationship in your life, wives, if you have children, is with your husband. We have veered off track. Now, we need to disciple our children. Absolutely, yes and amen. But we have to put effort into our marriages. Can I just tell you as a pastor how tired I am of seeing people who stay together for their children? And when their children are old enough to move out of the house, which is getting later and later, according to studies, I mean, you know, and sometimes they come back in. But when those kids leave the house, the husband and wife, they don't know each other. And the reason that they don't know each other is because for a long time they forgot Genesis 2, 24. They forgot that the foundational relationship in their home is that of husband and wife. This is hard. Listen, we're in it. We're in the middle of it. We need to love our children. We need to teach our children. But we need to be careful that we are not living our lives for our children. Because if we're not careful, we will wake up one day next to a stranger that wants out. We need to prioritize that relationship. By the way, your children need to see you prioritizing your marriage, because someday they also might be married, and they'll need to prioritize their marriage as well. And you say, well, I'd love to do that, but I don't have anybody to watch our kids so we can go to lunch or coffee. And I think there's a lot of senior adults in here today that would love to do that for you. We can get you connected. They're not all going to volunteer at once, but I think they're out there. Paul Tripp tells us in his book, Marriage, which I highly recommend to you, Paul Tripp's book on marriage. Marriage is about weeding and feeding. Marriage is about planting seeds and pulling weeds. Marriage is about planting seeds of love regularly and pulling weeds that creep up regularly. Let's keep going. Discipline consistently. Larry, don't put that next slide up there, okay? Just wait just a second. I want y'all to fill in this verse. I want you to shout it out, what you think the answer is. What does this verse say? Spare the rod. Wrong. That's not what this verse says. Put the verse up there. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24. Whoever spares the rod hates his son. But he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. We say spare the rod, spoil the child. The Bible says spare the rod, hate the child. If you love your child, you discipline him. By the way, the Bible says that the Lord disciplines those that he loves. Aren't you thankful for the discipline of the Lord in your life? So we need to discipline our children. Here are some sub-points for us. We need to be clear. We need to be united. Mom and dad don't need to have separate rules. So we need to be clear on what our rules are. We need to be united on what they are. We need to be consistent, letting our yes be yes and our no be no on whatever those rules are. And when we fail, and you absolutely will, keep trying. Keep trying. You will be accused of being the worst parent that ever existed because no other parent is doing what you're doing, and you need to learn two words for your children, and they are, who cares? Come on, say it with me. Who cares? I love that. Dad, their parents let them play video games 6 hours a day. Who cares? It just makes you feel good. Just to say it. And it's okay. I'm not that kid's dad. That kid might end up being an axe murderer. I don't know. You know, you might end up being an axe murderer. Who knows? Be clear, be united, be consistent, and when you fail, keep trying. Last one. This brings us to the last point today. Don't give up. Now, don't raise your hands, but man, anybody ever just feel like giving up, but then you can't? Like, you can't. It's a job. You can't quit. You can't give your resignation to your children. Like, here's my 2 weeks. You know, I just, you know, if you did, you'd like when they. When they turn like 16, you just go ahead and just give it to them right then. Just don't give up. Don't give up. I know that our church can help you. Pastor Travis is doing some parent training. I think there are at least four this year for parents of teenagers. And I would encourage you to try to make those. Because in those trainings, we're going to learn, like, how do we love our children with technology? How do we bring good discipline into our home? How do we disciple our children? What are effective ways to do that? Listen, I think what you'll find at trainings like that is other parents in the same stage that you are that just want to give up. So don't give up. So when there was a shortage of semiconductors, we all broke out our manuals and we started using them. Or started taking our car to the shop and the mechanics got very busy. Now the Bible is chock full of guides for us in parenting. I could do this series, like I could go 10 more weeks and just give you more principles from the Word of God. But the good news is, if you have a copy of the Word of God, you have the manual. So I want to encourage you, when you're discouraged, when you're down and out, when you can't see clearly, come back to the Word of God. Reach out for help. Reach out. If you don't know who to reach out to our church. You have children at home, you're wondering how to disciple, you're wondering what's wrong with them, you're wondering if you're normal. Reach out. Let our kids ministry equip you and help you. And if you have a teenager in the home and you just need some help, which is pretty much everybody that has a teenager in the home, and you're needing help, call. Let us come alongside you. Let us help you. Let us encourage you. It'd be good for you to be in a life group, because you'd be in a life group with people who are either walking through it or have walked through it, to pray for you, to encourage you in this crazy world called parenting. So I thought we might just end today in a different way. And if we would you mind, if you're in the room today, if you have teenagers in the house, teenagers or younger, would you just stand up wherever you are? Teenagers or younger? All right, look around, y'all. Put these people on your prayer list. You guys, just if you just remain standing, can I just voice a prayer over them? Now, I want you to look around the room. If you're sitting down and you've already gone through this stage, like, look at these couples. Consider an opportunity, if you've already been there, consider an opportunity to get to know one of these couples, to pour into one of these couples. They need you. They need somebody in their lives to tell them they're not crazy and to keep going. They need you. It's what it means to be the church. If all they have is each other, they're going to all just think they're all crazy. They need you. I want to pray for us, and then we're going to sing a song in response and be dismissed. Father, we're grateful for today. We're grateful for the privilege of parenting. Grateful for the privilege of raising up the next generation. Lord, I've been joking today because it's really a hard subject, but we have been given an incredible opportunity to raise up the next generation, to pass along the baton of faith. We've been given the opportunity to share your ways and your word with the next generation. And God, we want to be faithful with the baton. And God, for the people in the room who are standing, who are in the middle of it, in the thick of it right now, would you strengthen them? God, would they know that you are with them, that you are for them, and that they are not alone? And that even though they failed, God, that they're not failures. So God, would you help them to walk in your strength and in your power? And God, as a church, I pray that we might come alongside each other and support each other, be there for each other, and see the beauty of the church. We pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, let's everybody stand, and let me just say one last thing before Cody leads us in a song. Do not try to walk on this journey without having a relationship with Jesus. And if today you don't have a relationship with Jesus, it would be a privilege to share Christ with you. If today you're on the journey and you need prayer, it'd be a privilege to pray with you. We've got Pastor Denny here, and Pastor Denny has raised kids and now has grandkids. It'd be his honor to pray with you and pray for you. Let's sing to the Lord together.